ex-professor turned convenience store robber? Reports are in that Greyburn College's former physics and biology professor, Dr. Bruce Banner, was cited committing an armed robbery at a local Diamond Drive an hour ago. Banner was heading a study trying to enhance soldiers' abilities in war zones, but when things went south, he was fired from ever teaching again at New York colleges. Now he finds himself in police custody. How things have gone from worse to worst for Dr. Banner.
Welcome to Ravencroft, Banner. Skinny buck like you's got no chance of escaping here.
I'm closely watched by two men in guard uniforms. Marched from the squad car that brought me to Ravencroft, to the front door. Spotlight searched the prison yard below in the gathering darkness. Snipers prepared to take down any vagabonds looking to escape. As I head closer to my fate, I can't help but think of everything that's happened to me these past few days. I try to block it all out. I'd rather suppress it than deal with it head on. Not now.
Come on! Faster, punk!
I'm shoved by the other guard, taller and thinner than the one in front of me leading the way. He reeks of cigarettes. I give him the side eye before picking up the pace. Stay calm, Bruce. Don't let the monster out.
Right this way, pal. Paradise awaits.
Ravencroft's notorious for housing the worst of the criminal crowd. But no super criminals to worry about in here. That's at least a plus. I both dread and welcome my punishment. This is what I deserve. But keeping myself under control will be the real challenge. This isn't a stress-free environment. It's where I belong. I walk past slimy, grungy crooks and murderers. They eye me up. I'm on the menu for a while. Fresh meat.
You won't last a day in here, boy.
I'ma rip you apart, little man!
Have a good first day. It's the beginning of the end for ya.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. If only these assholes knew what I've got under my sleeve. The guards moved me along, not wanting the inmates to get too much of a sneak preview of me. I'm brought into a white side room and the door is closed behind me. I must say, the place is quite clean. Whoever's responsible for that is doing a good job. Cleanest prison I've been to. Well, it's the only prison I've been to, but still. The cigarette guard searches me again, just in case I stole a pencil from the back of the squad car or something. His rough hands move all over my body before he steps away from me again.
Here, just for you.
Aww, he shouldn't have. My very own orange prison jumpsuit. In season this year, too. I quickly change into it. The guard's not even bothering to give me even a little privacy. It's one size too big. It feels good being out of those sweaty criminal rags. I'm reminded of what Betty told me when I got fired. Stay positive. If you're on a sinking ship, at least you can swim. Here's to staying afloat. I'm going to be here a while. Now that I'm done putting on my strip show for the guards, I'm led back into the main heart of the prison. More glares and evil smiles for me as they take me to potentially my final resting place. A cozy little lot for two, with room for one. The plumbing probably feels like warm pee. Certainly smells like it in there. So much for Bravo cleaning crew. Beds look like leftover prop from the Flintstones. I'm sure they feel like it too. A short, balding man with circular glasses looks up from his newspaper on the top bunk.
You my new roomie?
Looks like it. The man leaps down from the bunk and adjusts his glasses before sticking out his hand.
I'm Oswald!
Bruce, I shake his sweaty hand. Well, at least it's not some beefy guy to attempt to use me as a human punching bag before the other guy turns him into a squished ketchup packet.
Lights out in 10!
Thanks, Paul. Say, how's your wife? Did you get the flowers I sent her?
Shut the hell up!
That right there is one of the most fun half-times Ravencroft has, my friend. They beat you up with their billy clubs, you pound them with your words. The more they hurt you, the more you know you got them. Here, look at this.
Oswald pulls up his shirt away to reveal his chest. Discolored bruises proudly displayed by him like an athlete parading in their medallions. He quickly tucks his shirt back down.
We're stuck with each other for a while, so may as well get to know each other, right?
I suppose so.
So, we got your standard prison question right here. Works for hell, too. What'd you do to get in here?
Tried to rob a diamond drive.
You serious? You're telling me you got sent to Ravencroft for robbing a convenience store? Oh man, your lawyers screwed you. How long you got?
12 years.
12 years? Now say goodbye to a decade, my friend. You don't got a kid, do you?
Not even a wife.
Ah, well, that's at least something. Damn. Convenience store. Oh, you trying to steal those road hot dogs or something? I mean, why not a bank? Hell, even a post office. Hey, good money there.
I just thought it'd be easier.
Well, guess you thought wrong since you ended up here anyway.
Oswald climbs back up to the top bunk.
Hey, you cool with taking the bottom? I like it up here. It makes me feel powerful. Like one tall bastard looking down on the world.
You really are something. You know that?
That's what they keep saying.
I take my place on the bottom bunk. And it's not as bad as I thought it'd be. It's worse. I thought about telling Oswald more. Explaining what I'm doing here and who I really am since, like he said, we'll be stuck with each other for a while. Another Betty quote forms in my head. Don't keep everything bottled up, or you'll erupt. Sorry, Betty. But for now, my troubles are staying in. I need a distraction. Hopefully this gets Oswald going. What about you, Oz? How'd a guy like you end up here?
Oz, huh? Yeah, my mother used to call me that. Just don't call me a wizard or nothing goofy like that.
Sure thing. So?
I'm glad you asked, Brucey. So there I was back in my apartment. Nice place once you lay down some cockroach traps, watching some TV. I think it was the Golden Girls or something. Anyway, I get this call from an old high school buddy asking for help with his job. The details weren't very specific, just I needed a mask and a gun. Really, I was bored out of my mind, so I jumped at the opportunity to do something. Even if it might not have been fully within the bounds of the law, you know? He picks me up in this sleek-looking black van with these other masked men and tells me to hop in. It's getting a real heist movie vibes here, you know? Like we were in the town or whatever. I start trying to converse with the guys, just being friendly, but they weren't having anything of it. One guy pointed his gun at me and told me to shut up. You believe that? Telling me to shut up. We arrive at this real ritzy-looking bank and my head starts racing. Am I really this nuts trying this for a friend I haven't seen in a decade? Well, as you can see, I was crazy enough to. One of his other friends leads the way, right? And right out of the gate, grabs some broad and takes her hostage. Everyone's going mad in there, like a carnival on cocaine. I'm trying to process it as all the gunshots whizzing by. My so-called friend just killed one of the bank guards. He shoves me ahead in the bank vault and gives me a felt bag as his other pal goes and thermites the door, right? Frickin' clatters to the ground and I'm pushed to collect all the cash. Stuff's piled up high, man. I can't imagine what people like Stark feel like walking into their vaults. I feel a wave of greed wash over me as I stuff as much as I can in the bag. Before long, I start hearing police sirens yelling out, "Come on!" I hear one of the thugs yelling at me and they run out of there like rabbits getting chased by a fox. I try to go with them, but I trip and the money spills all over the place. Before I know it, I'm in cuffs, sitting in the back of a cop car. I was given a bargain. Gave up the names of the other guys, get my time knocked off my sentence. Did I take it? I wish, but turns out, dear old pal worked with the mafia, and they sent me death threats. If I squealed, I wouldn't survive this lovely little slice of heaven. So in short, if you get a call from your old high school buddy, never—
God, will you shut up and let us go to sleep already?
How up yours, Jackson?
It's Jason!
Like I care! Anyways, night prison, buddy.
Oswald's story provided me with some entertainment, but I know all hopes of a peaceful sleep are non-existent. My eyes begin to close, and I do what I can to prepare myself for the nightmares. I'm never prepared. Elsewhere in a chemistry lab on the outskirts of New York City, a man continues his work on a formula while ignoring the news in the background. He jots down his thoughts as they fly through his head, hardly able to write them down fast enough. His eyes dart from his own writings to the papers of others he deems adequately intelligent. He smiles at one redacted document he hacked out of Grayburn College's archives, and they were none the wiser. The article of interest is entitled, "Erskine's Super Soldier Serum Reimagined Through Gamma Radiation," written by Dr. Bruce Banner. The man rubs his mustache as he finishes sketching what he believes to be his winning formula. This man, however, is no ordinary man. Samuel Stearns' head is grotesquely large, and like the rest of his body, green after a failed experiment. Well, partially failed. Although he was not any stronger than he once was, his ability to comprehend any set of knowledge was incredibly heightened. His mind and brain are so developed that he possesses the will to control simpletons and make them do his bidding.
It seems I need test subjects for this experiment. Vagabonds that will follow orders without any question.
This just in. A shootout is in progress in the area of Westbrook Drive and 11th Street. All citizens are warned to not go near the action. Police are on site right now attempting to take down the perpetrators. More updates will come in when we get more information. Stay tuned and stay safe.
Common criminals could do the trick. It's time for them to get an upgrade, it seems.
Stearns prepares himself to go on a little trip as best he can. He knows the possibility of being completely incognito is impossible in his current state, but does the best he can with what he has. He throws on a cloak and pulls up the hood over a sizable portion of his cranium. With a dramatic swish of his cloak, Stearns struts out of his laboratory and travels to the location of the shootout. In the heat of the action, a few masked criminals run away with a large trash bag filled with freshly stolen cash. Bullets skid around them. Police officers run full force at them. Unfortunately for a young officer, the crooks mean business and are not about to be thrown in jail again. One of the men gets off a shot, hitting the officer straight at her heart. She slams down on the ground, and her partner drops dead in her tracks.
McNally, God damn it. You bastards! Officer down, we need backup here.
Nice going, Wrecker! Now they're saying in even more cops! Why'd you kill her?
Quit whining, you idiot! This'll slow them down a little.
But not forever. They'll catch up to us, and thanks to you, we're the hell of a lot more pigs. Do you know what they do to cop killers in jail?
Just shut up! I'm trying to think!
Well, do it faster!
Suddenly, a car pulls up in front of them, and they all stop to a screeching halt.
Perfect! Give us the car, freak, or I'll splatter you all over the pavement!
No, no, no. Now I'm afraid that won't do. I suggest you all come with me. We have business to take care of.
Who the hell are you? And what's wrong with your face?
You're one of the mutants, weirdo!
Oh, never mind that now. I command you to get in this car!
The wrecking crew hesitates for a moment, but one by one they're taken under Stearns' spell, and all pile into the car.
Gentlemen, today's a day you certainly won't forget.
The evil genius steps on the gas, leaving the police behind in the dust, desperately searching for a sign of where the four men went.
You let this happen.
No time for sleep, Banner!
I wake up in a flash without even thinking, slamming my head on the top bunk.
God damn it!
For a moment, I'd forgotten I was still in jail. Hard to forget, really, with a bed like this. Felt like I slept on a pile of gravel last night. I'm sure even that would have been more comfortable. Glad to see I didn't wake up my neighbor. I walk over to the sink, a little afraid of how many diseases I'm going to contract just by touching the water. The pipes rattle a little as a steady flow of water streams out. Looks clean enough. I dip my hands in and wash my face. The cool water feels nice, like I'm washing my face for the first time in a month. I haven't seen myself in a while. I fear what I'll see when I look in the mirror. My eyes slowly move up, expecting the worst. It's worse than I expected. I jump back in fear when I see what or who's staring back at me. Hulk's angry green face stares back at me with his monstrous eyes. I rub my eyes and cautiously look back in the mirror. A scraggly man looks back at me, tiredness leaking from his eyes, bags just under them. A brown beard wraps around his face. A little unkempt. Much better. Well, not too much better. But I'd rather see my ugly mug than a huge green monster any day.
Had a nightmare.
I turn around to find Oswald sitting up in his bed, all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. He's certainly adapted to prison life. Something like that.
You know, I was dating this therapist girl back in the day. And she told me dreams mean something. Of course, she turned it all around on me, saying my nightmare about drowning in a frozen lake was linked to my commitment problems and being overwhelmed with trying to make our relationship work. Like, that makes any sense. I think it's pretty obvious a nightmare about drowning means I'm afraid of drowning. You get me?
Seems logical.
So, what plagues your subconscious? Bet I'm a better therapist than Bethany. You can't go to college and learn the stuff I know.
Nothing too serious. I just have this reoccurring dream. I'm in the city and this huge monster keeps running at me. No matter where I try to hide, it always finds me.
Yeesh. Sounds like what you need is a nice balanced breakfast. Lucky for you, our chefs are here from all over the world. We're talking Jersey, Staten Island, even got one from Buffalo. I swear them burgers we had last week were made of buffalo. Damn. Anyway, you'll really love what they do with the eggs here, too. Well, we're pretty sure they're eggs, but the lab reports ain't back yet. So, you hungry?
Starving.
All right, get up, you filthy ladies. Chow time!
Oswald and I join the rest of the horde heading for the canteen. We pass a few of Ravencroft's finest. Buff guys with hefty beards. A skinny guy with daggers for teeth. One of the men from my first day. A very slim and bald guy that looks like a stiff wind could crumble him up into a ball. He's got a smug look on his face, and a smirk to compliment it. Oz waves at all of them. All smiles, and they, of course, sneer their responses. Some even flip him off. Out of all the people I could have been paired up with, Oswald is the best possible outcome. Anyone else would have murdered me in my sleep on the first night, or poisoned me slowly. That certainly would let out the monster. We arrive at the canteen. Reminds me of a lovely little French cafe that was recently hit by an asteroid. Got in line, I could already smell the sweet smell of prison food. Eggs that are probably more like eggnog than solid chunks, toast left over from a bombing site, jelly from World War II, the typical American nuclear family's breakfast. Nothing short of excellence. Oswald and I sit down at a table a little away from a few groups. No doubt the prison triads.
So, Brucey, let old Dr. Oz show you the ropes of Ravencroft. Quick little guide on how to survive and who not to screw with.
Never thought of writing a book?
Limited appeal. Plus half the guys here probably can't even read. So, you see that bastard over there? The big ugly one?
You'll have to be a little more specific than that.
Alright, good point. Okay, we're talking the big white guy with the curly hair. There's Baldy.
Baldy?
Here's the deal. You ever heard of that Iron Fist shit? Or whatever? How it's passed down from generation to generation?
Who?
Never mind. But basically, there was Baldy here before. But then, Big Lug over there beats the ever-loving shit out of the Big Lug who was here, and he died. I think he stole his watch or something petty like that. Anyway, he kept the name and became the new Baldy.
So he's called Baldy because he killed the last Baldy.
Exactly.
Makes perfect sense.
Common sense ain't nothing that exists here, friend. Wait, no. Lenny stole a watch. Apparently Baldy and ex-Baldy were after the same chick. Veronica or something like that? Heard she's a knockout. Hope she's worth dying for. You got a lady, roomie?
It's complicated.
Always is. Women. Can't live with them, can't live without them. Where was I?
Baldy?
Yeah. So stay clear of Baldy and never mention his girl. Or your head will turn into a pancake.
Noted. Who's next? I take a bite out of the drywall disguised as toast. Probably almost chipping a tooth.
Next up we got Prick. See the egghead in the glasses over there? Am I right?
I see him. So what's his deal?
That guy was in a library late at night, reading Socrates or some other smart guy like Plato or whatever. Librarian comes in, says he's gotta go. Prick asks him to come closer and repeat what he said. So he does, stepping closer. Prick launches up and beats the hell out of the poor guy with a book. A goddamn book! Can you believe it? Then he goes back to reading it as the guy's bleeding out on the floor. Thinks he's some kind of philosopher, really he's just...
Prick?
Hey, you're catching on fast. Baldy may be one of the toughest guys here, but Prick's the most psychotic. The guy's like a slippery anaconda.
So where'd he get the nickname?
The guards always called him that. And I guess it just sort of caught on with the rest of us. Now I got one man left for you. We're talking a serious threat. This guy makes Prick and Baldy look like Elmo and the Cookie Monster. Ranger. So named because he's an ex-army ranger. Went on some sort of freak-ass vendetta. Killing his entire company when they got home. Never told a living soul why he did it neither. Only the dead understand. Last guy he decapitated with a rusty knife. Took him hours before the head came off. Eh, so they say. Police found him just waiting there. Head in his goddamn hands. Heard his lawyer wanted him to go in for an insanity plea, and he probably would have gotten it. But he said no. These guys were in a league of their own. The Holy Trinity turned horrid. You get on the shit list, you better start writing a will.
And here I thought my stay here couldn't get any better.
Well, now you know the neighborhood. At least the bad side. Don't worry though, pal. Old Oz will take care of you.
I smile my appreciation. With this much heat in here, I better just keep my head down and mind my own business. For the sake of everyone in here. A rugged older man walks up to Oswald with a tray of what the chefs call food. Oswald smiles slightly at the appearance of this new face.
What's the word, Gus?
Paul told me it's happening tomorrow night. You in?
I haven't even recovered since the last time. Well, he gave me a walloping.
You gonna at least watch?
What kind of stupid question is that? Of course I'm not missing it.
I'll see you there. Don't forget, you owe me 6 stamps from that last bet.
Yeah. Get out of here, you lemon.
Gus nods, and I return the gesture as he walks off to another table. I turn my attention to Oswald, giving him a confused look and hoping he'll explain.
Seems I haven't nearly taught you everything yet. Every month, that tall asshole guard Paul lets some of us out at the crack of midnight for a fight club. Pretty crazy, right? Rides us all with some much-needed entertainment and helps get the anger out. I participate sometimes, but what I'm really after is the betting around it.
Oswald reaches into his jumpsuit's chest pocket and pulls out a few postage stamps and slams them down on the table. Planning on mailing a letter to your mother?
Wouldn't dream of wasting these beauties. These, my friend, are what the prison runs off of. Them prison movies always use cigarettes as currency, but here's where the real money is. Stamps. You got a letter, save the stamp. Got it?
Who'd write me?
I don't know, that complicated girlfriend of yours?
Not likely.
Queen England, then? Perhaps Elvis? Robert Downey Jr.? Whoever, just make sure you save the stamps. Here's a little investment for you.
Oswald slides over 4 of his prison bucks and I pick them up, examining them for a moment.
Hey, relax, they're not counterfeit.
Thanks, Oz.
Forget about it.
For the rest of our breakfast period, Oz tells me about his life before Ravencroft, and all of the random and oddly specific stories he's locked up in his brain. After our meal, we return to our cells and tidy up before morning exercise. All of the tough guys lift weights, making sure everyone knows how heavy they are by grunting incredibly loudly and allowing the weights to clatter down to the ground when they're done. The rest of the prisoners do jumping jacks and push-ups away from the lifting portion. Baldy sneers at the lightweights.
Bunch of pussies.
I head over to a bench press with Oswald, lying down on it and doing a few reps. One of the very few advantages of having the Hulk buried in me like a disease is that I retain some of his strength. Sure, I can't stop a bullet train with my bare hands, but I can definitely open up a pickle jar with ease.
Jeez, you're stronger than you look. That's 180 pounds you got on you there. I'm surprised your skinny little arms haven't snapped like pretzels there, Professor.
I smile up at him. But then, I see a figure moving in. Ranger.
What do you think you're doing there, fresh meat?
Hey, relax, man. You'll be done in a sec, then you can have the spot all to yourself.
I don't like sharing. You of all people should know that this is my spot.
I set the bar back down and start to get up, but Ranger's firm hand pushes me back down.
But you know what? Since this is your first week and all, I'll let you continue out of the goodness of my heart.
Both Oswald and I look at him suspiciously, but he gives us a grin. Well, as much of a grin as he can muster. Looks more sinister than kind. I return back to the bench press, not wanting to argue with Ranger and start something. I begin another set of reps, not breaking a sweat yet. I hear Ranger snap his fingers, and his 2 cronies join us.
Ma, pretty strong, aren't you, freshy?
Why don't we see just how strong you are?
Before I know it, more weights are added to my barbell. I start to strain a little, but I keep on going. I can't let them win this one. But I have to keep myself under control, too. I'm walking a tightrope.
Not bad. But I think you could do better.
More weights. My muscles are screaming at me, and sweat is beginning to stream out like a leaky faucet. I feel him. The monster within me. He's closer than he's ever been. I have to stop. If they keep this up, they'll be gone. Worse than gone. Obliterated. Thankfully, looks like my feat of strength is enough for them. They stop adding weights.
All right, boys, I think he's proven himself. You take my spot again, though, punk, and I'll bury you.
He can try to bury me. No. Stay in control, Bruce. The horrid Trinity walks off to annoy someone else, and Oswald looks at me with disbelief as I set the barbell back in place and get up.
How in the hell did you do that? You taking steroids or something?
My adrenaline kicked in, I guess.
You're crazy, you know that? You know, I could have sworn I saw a little green in your eyes when they piled on all those weights.
Just a trick of the light. Back at Stearns' lab, he begins conducting his terrible experiment, only telling the wrecking crew the positive outcomes, and not warning them of the terrible possible conditions. All four men sit on chairs in front of his chemist equipment. He snags a clipboard, and reads over it as a camera records the entire procedure.
Dr. Samuel Stearns, Super Soldier 3.0, Experiment Number 27. This experiment is attempted to replicate Erskine's original Super Soldier Serum from 1941. Tragically, Erskine destroyed any records of the formula, and when he died, was lost in time. Today, I, with my intellect, have created a project better than the dear doctor could ever dream of. In front of me are test subjects Dirk Garthwaite, age 30. Elliot Franklin, age 36, Brian Philip Kaluski, age 27, and Henry Camp, age 32. All of my test subjects are in peak condition.
Thanks, Doc.
Shut up, cretin.
Shutting up.
As I was saying, today we make them alpha males, keys to the survival of the human race, which weakens with each generation. Let us begin. First, a shot of penicillin for each subject.
The leader walks to each of the men and injects them with penicillin. A few of them wince, hoping that will be the worst of it. They are sorely mistaken.
Next, we introduce their bodies to my concoction and irradiate them with gamma rays to activate it. If the procedure fails, then I must exterminate the lab rats.
Now, hold on a second. You said this would be a guaranteed success. What the hell do you mean, exterminate the lab rats?
I said it should be. Science requires sacrifice to succeed. Remain calm. This will be over before you think.
A wave of calming floods all of them. Now Stearns pulls out green vials of his serum and begins injecting them in each one of the wrecking crew's bare arms. The winces turn into teeth gritting. The formula feels like burning hot lava surging into their veins. The leader steps back once the last test subject has his serum and fires up his gamma exposure machine. It takes a moment to start up, but when it does, it blasts the men full of radiation, and Stearns watches curiously. The men's muscles swell and their legs lengthen. Pain runs rampant all over their bodies. Their eyes suddenly become green. The leader watches them closely, hoping the results will level out instead of spiking out of control. His hopes are met. Stearns cuts power to the machine, and none of the crew hulk out. The leader applauds himself.
You see, gentlemen, my experiment was indeed a success. As if there were any doubts in my competence. How do you all feel?
I feel like I could play for the Yankees!
You, put your powers to the test. Punch that wall.
Piledriver stands up out of his chair and punches the brick wall as hard as he can, surprised to see a huge hole crashes open.
Holy shit!
Ha! Finally! Now that I have you all under my control, my plan to purify and strengthen the human race will become a reality. First, my goons, we shall break into Ravencroft and take one Dr. Bruce Banner.
What the hell do we need him for?
Because, my friends, my powers of deduction have provided me with this information. With blood left at the scene of Abomination's duel with the Hulk, I found that Hulk's blood matches to Bruce Banner's, recently imprisoned in Ravencroft Penitentiary. Our plan is simple. With your strength and my brain, we will break into Ravencroft when the time is right. Together with the Hulk, the Wrecking Crew would be unstoppable.
When the time is right, why not go bust this guy out now?
It is all in the timing. A new disease is arriving at the CDC in 2 weeks. A piece of the next phase of my plan. The clock is ticking for the Homo sapiens. It's time for the Alpha to rise!
Back in prison, my first 2 full days are going surprisingly well, but I'm sure the shit will pour back in somehow. I'd started to learn the ways of jail thanks to Oswald, and I'm beginning to get into the strict routine. I had a lot of free time on my hands, but I didn't want to be stuck with my thoughts. I'd usually spend my hours in the library, or listening to some of Oz's iconic stories. The man was like a walking library himself. The real library didn't house any books on quantum physics or anything like that, sadly, but it had a surprising amount of classics lining its shelves. I suppose it's to help us prison folk become more well-rounded individuals so we can compete on Jeopardy once our sentence is over. I'm currently reading Little Dorrit. It's weird seeing books about prison escapes like The Count of Monte Cristo in here, but hey, if anyone takes one of them for inspiration, the guards will know exactly how to toss them back in. Really. They're more like booby traps. Daylife is pretty standard, but nightlife, tonight, is about to get interesting. Late at night, footsteps clatter around and Oswald joins in, hopping down from his bunk. He's about to wake me up when I rise up too. Sleep hasn't been my thing lately.
Ah, good, you're up. Don't want to miss this?
What's going on?
Tonight's entertainment, of course! The moment you've been waiting for, Ravencroft's own fight night!
Before I could say anything, the tobacco addict guard unlocks our cell next and motions us out.
Thank you, Paul. Looking lovely as ever.
He rolls his eyes and points at me, still standing behind in the cell.
You coming or what, freshie?
I consider staying. If I get wrapped up in a fight, it's all over. But I knew the guard wasn't going to give me much of a choice, so I comply. He leads me, Oswald, and a few stragglers down past mostly empty cells into the prison basement. A place I've yet to see. It was eerily quiet there as we climbed down the stairs. Men stood in a circle inside the near darkness, surrounding the one lit spot in the whole basement. The fighting ring. Oswald nudges me with his elbows, smiling in excitement. We find our station and stand, waiting for the guard to say something. He coolly strides into the center like he's the talk of the town. And in this moment, he is.
Good to see so many of you ugly mugs here tonight. We've got some exciting fights coming up. Whoever wins the final round gets a pack of cigs and a free day. Blood will be spilt, teeth will be kicked out, and a little surprise for this night. We've got Freshie here. Let's see how our newest member of this fine prison holds up against the scum of the earth. First match, Baldy against Slick Joe.
Shit, shit, shit! This is why the guard was so keen on getting me here. I'm tonight's entertainment. And if I'm not in control, this'll be a mass funeral. Just relax, Bruce. Think of this as a test. God damn it! Oswald looks at me with a worried expression.
Shit, Bruce, I didn't know, honest.
It's fine.
What are you gonna do? I could distract Paul while you slip out.
He'd pay me a visit later and beat the hell out of me when he found out.
Good point. Damn it!
I'm gonna fight. It's my only option.
You ever been in a fight before?
Of course. The college I taught at had a secret underground fight club. I went Tuesdays and Saturdays.
Wait, really?
No. I've never been in a fight.
Well, shit. Hey, you're a strong enough guy, so maybe you can make it work. Whatever you got, punch him fast and hard in the pressure points. Storm at him. Hopefully you can end it quick, or they'll end you quick.
All right. I can do this. hit the pressure points.
My stamps are on you, pal.
Oswald pats my shoulder, just as Slick Joe is knocked out by Baldy. Blood is splattered on the once clean concrete, and Baldy's meaty fist is stained already.
Who's next? Come on! Baldy needs more blood!
Another brick of a man steps up to accept the challenge, and Baldy smiles, showing his missing teeth with pride. Stamps are passed around, most of them probably betting on Baldy's certain victory. I scan the circle, and my eyes stop on a little girl. I look at her in shock. What is she doing here? It can't be her. Fear spreads over me. She's just a memory. Nothing more. She's not here. She's not here. She vanishes, just like that. I rub my eyes. It must be lack of sleep. I continue looking around and find Ranger and Prick, both with their twisted smiles and stacks of stamps. Ranger catches me staring and motions for me. I hesitate. What could he want? He motions again and I give in. The fight starts as I walk around the outside of the ring, not wanting to be walloped before my time. Baldy strikes the first few punches, skidding the challenger back. I reach Ranger when Baldy's punched by his opponent, but he doesn't fly back. Looks like his challenger might already be done.
How's it hanging, fresh meat?
I don't respond. I just look at him in the eyes with rage.
Not too friendly, I see, Professor. Well, me and Prick here have a proposition for you. When you fight Baldy, we want you to take a dive.
And why would I do that?
For one, you'd be a lot less damaged and, well, alive. You couldn't make it through a full round head-to-head with the janitor, let alone our big brute. Secondly, we'll give you stamps. 100.
I think for a moment. Once again, I'm pinned down. I shake Prick's greasy hand in agreement, and they both smile.
Glad you could see it our way. Enjoy the rest of the fights.
I nod and walk off, fully knowing I wouldn't keep my side of the bargain. It's time to put the horrid Trinity in their place. More blood spills on the battleground and the watchers go crazy. Stamps are being passed around in a fury. People are clapping and booing. Eyes are filled with wildfire. More violence. More blood. They demand. They think I'll be the sacrificial lamb, but they'll be wrong. Or maybe I'm just overconfident. Here goes something. I catch Oz's eye as Gus chats him up and nod at him. His face gains a look of concern, knowing what happens when over 300 pounds of muscle tries to beat up Baldy. What's going to happen to a pencil?
Keep him coming, you limp dick bastards! Can none of yous knock me out? Ha ha ha! Who's next?
That would be me. I deliver a blow right at his ribs, and before he can react, another to his throat. He falls back down on the ground, choking for a moment. The crowd goes silent.
Holy shit!
My victory is short-lived, though. Baldy rises from the ground, looking as angry as the monster in me. He launches at me, and I have no idea what I'm doing. Some sort of instinct kicks in. Or maybe it's the other guy. I veer out of the way in the nick of time, and Baldy slams on the brakes, just missing a portion of the bloodthirsty crowd. He wheels around and swings at me again, but I duck. I fire back with a punch to the jaw, my fist landing hard on my target. I try for a second hit, but that was a mistake.
Gotcha now, you son of a bitch!
He grabs my fist with his meat claw and slams his other hand on my shoulder.
Yeah!
He throws me. My back hits the cold ground hard. I'm winded. The Goliath lumbers over to finish me. I feel something inside me, like energy surging. Control it. No. Baldy's right over me, punch swinging down at me in slow motion. But I lash out, blow after blow on his ribs, a sickening crunch as my fists continue to impact like meteors. I aim a few to his throat, and the tower finally falls. I did it.
That's my boy right there! Yeah!
I smile. I actually smile. But then, it all goes tumbling down. I feel a hard hit to the back of my head, and I black out. Just before I do, though, I see that same little girl standing over me. My eyes close. I wake up trapped in Hulk's body, merely an audience member in this monster's show. I try to act like his conscience sometimes, but he's stubborn. I look around, trying to get my bearings. Looks like a suburb of New York City. Then it clicks. Abomination. I see him standing at the other end of the street, rampaging forward with no regard for the architecture of the area.
Hulk smash abomination!
Wise words, Hulk. We charge at him. I feel Hulk's strength power me and excite me. It's like a drug, with horrible side effects. Mainly, death and destruction. We rip off part of a building and chuck it at the hideous monster still raging at us. It hits him right in the head, but he only slows down for a moment. We launch right at him, bounding several feet in the air before smashing him down to the street. The ground shakes, and large pieces of road crack under our weight. The remaining citizens on the block stream out in panic, hoping to find a safe haven. Abomination punches at us with the power of a freight train behind each blow. We feel every one of those together, as we're now flung back into a building.
Stupid monster! Hulk, destroy!
I rip free of the building and pile drive right into Abomination, sending us both through a series of structures until we're in an apartment complex. Rage fills me up, and I pick up anything I can and continuously slam it into Abomination. Rock after rock, breaking in my hands while the beast struggles to toss me off. More. More! His strength depletes, and more of my hits crumble into his beaten body. I lift up a sizable chunk of wall from the ground by me. But something catches my eye. No. No, 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 no. Tears start to sting my eyes. Shock and self-hatred flows through me. I toss the wall away and slowly turn back into myself. What have I done? I start to break down, punching the ground and bloodying my fists while hot tears stream down.
Bruce. Hey Bruce! Wake up, pal! Come on, wake up!
My eyelids jolt open, and the bright white light blinds me for a second until I adjust. My head is propped up on a comfortable pillow, and my body on a fluffy bed. I'm in the prison hospital ward. Oswald stands over me, smiling at my now open eyes.
Oh, thank God. I was worried about you. I thought you'd be in a coma or something with that cheap blow Ranger gave you.
What?
The fight, man. The fight! I couldn't believe you with that Rocky Balboa-looking shit. Incredible! You knocked Baldy flat on his ass and broke a few other parts, too. Then that rat bastard Ranger punched your lights out when you weren't looking. Paul, that asshat made him the winner. So now he's all smiles out in the courtyard while a true hero in the night is busted up in a hospital wing. Comfy beds, though, right? You must have had some hell of a dream, though, man. You were tossing and turning like a boat in a storm. You good, man?
I'll live.
You know, you look like shit. You gotta shave off that beard.
I give him a small smile. But deep in my mind, my thoughts are clouded with dark thoughts. My burden. Compared to the shit show that was Wednesday night, the rest of my week was pretty routine. Finally did shave that beard. I'm beginning to look like my old nerdy self again, instead of a caveman. The Trinity keeps a watchful eye on me. Their revenge is coming soon. But for now, they're letting me sweat it out. Do I regret what I did? No. I showed the rest of the prison that a little twig like me can make a difference. Their hold on Ravencroft after that has slipped because of it too. These guys may be the big kahunas in here, but out in the real world, they're just a psycho ex-army ranger and two assholes with no real future. Some of the others have been treating me better too, calling me brave and a hero. After what happened that day in the New York apartment, I hate being called a hero. If these people knew what I did, they'd never even look at me again. Sunday afternoon, Oz and I were shooting the breeze, just before the unexpected happened.
So you're telling me you've never been to a Yankees game your entire life?
Never. Not really a fan of baseball.
Hey, neither am I, but I've been. My old pops took me one time when I was a kid. Just the atmosphere at all, the energy. Not much here on Earth like it, honest. The hot dogs, too, to die for. If your dad didn't take you to the ball game, did he at least take you fishing? I mean, I know it's cliche or whatever, but come on. It's one of them rites of passage.
My dad wasn't really there much. And when he was, he spent half of the time drunk and the other half angry at me and my mom for his problems.
Damn. That's some shit right there. Sorry, Bruce.
Hey, you didn't know. I felt powerless around him. Like some weak punk who couldn't do anything. Thankfully, my mom was there for it all. First date, driver's license, first ticket, graduation. She was my will to go on.
Mothers, right? You could pull the stupidest shit and they'd still love you.
Hey, Banner, you got a visitor!
I lift up suddenly at what he just said, nearly hitting my head on the top bunk again. A visitor? Who?
Some geeky broad. You want to see her?
Betty. I can't believe it. She's actually here. After that last time we spoke, I'm surprised she'd ever want to see me again, let alone talk. I quickly get out from my bunk, and Oswald gives me a wink.
Go get her, lady killer.
The guard unlocks the cell door and leads me out to the visitation area. The spot is a small nook with a few tables. The guard waits outside by the door as I walk in. The place is nearly empty, except for one familiar face. Betty. She's a brunette with black glasses over her beautiful hazel eyes I could look hours into. She looks up at me with a teary-eyed smile. My eyes start to feel the sting of fresh tears at her sight. I move to sit down, but before I do, she rushes up and gives me a firm hug. I enjoy her comforting touch, not feeling it for what seems like a lifetime. She lets go finally, and we take a seat.
I missed you so much, Bruce. What the hell did you do? Why didn't you say anything? And what's this about a convenience store robbery?
It's great to see you too, Betty. I thought you'd never want to talk to me again after what happened. Betty grabs my hands, and I nearly jump at the sudden contact.
Of course I want to talk to you. How else am I supposed to get answers? Sorry it took so long. Getting visitation here is a pain in the ass.
I'm just glad you're here. Life in here's not been easy. I've made a few enemies.
Typical. Any friends?
One. You'd like him. He's been looking out for me.
Good, good. Now, how about some answers, please?
Where do I begin?
The beginning would be nice.
You remember how I wanted to use the monster to help people after those first few months after the incident, right?
Of course. And then I told you to run more tests. And you did because you always listen to me, right? It's not like I saw him trampling around New York on the news shortly after heavily advising you not to.
You were right. I was an idiot, addicted to it. It made me feel more powerful than I've ever been. I felt invincible. It came with a heavy price. For one...
You left me without saying goodbye.
Yes. I should have explained why, but I couldn't bring myself to do it. The thought of saying goodbye hurt too much, so I went on, pretending everything was fine. I'm so sorry, Betty.
What would you have said to me?
That we can't be together, because if I lose control, I could kill you. There have been times where I can't control them, and the destruction is devastating. I felt happy knowing that you were safe away from me.
Bruce, I know the risks of being with you, and I don't care. If I die by your side, then at least I'm dying with someone I love. I can't stay away from you. We can figure this out. I need you, and you need me.
If I was the cause of your death, I'd lose it and never come back. The monster would win. Betty's warm hands touch mine, and she looks me in the eyes deeply.
I won't let that happen. I promise.
Besides, I'll be here for a while. It's where I need to be.
Where you need to be? Why? To isolate yourself from society?
Exactly. While I'm out there, I'm a danger to everyone around me. At least in here, I'm more contained.
You're not dealing with the problem, you're just shoving it off to the side. When did you lose your hope? You're Bruce Banner, for God's sake. If anyone can fix this, it's you.
Believe me, I've tried, and nothing I do helps.
Nothing yet, but that doesn't mean you should give up. There is something else you're not telling me. You're plagued with guilt. What happened?
I'm a murderer, Betty. I killed them. A whole family. A loving mother and a caring father. A 4-year-old girl that'll never fall in love. Never grow up and graduate from college. Get a job. Start a family. I see them in my nightmares. Every night. I imagine their voices crying and begging for the happy life they had before I ruined it. I'm not a hero. I can try to be all I want, but in the end, there'll be more innocent blood on my hands.
But think of all the lives you saved by stopping Abomination. You can't win them all, it's the sad truth. But because of you, another little girl will have all of those things and more.
It's because of me Abomination exists in the first place. It's clear that someone out there is trying to replicate my experiment. If I keep on trying the hero thing, more villains will rise up to challenge me again and again. It's an endless cycle of violence and death. I can't do it. I belong here, out of the way.
You won't get better if you keep doing this. You'll wallow and rot in here with the monster instead of ridding it from you completely. Please, reconsider. I can get you out of here.
Don't throw away your money bailing me out.
Not with money. This agency approached me looking for you. They'd get all of your charges cleared and you'd be free. Take this and think about it, okay?
Betty slides a business card to me, and I take it to make her happy. Not even bothering to look at it.
Thank you.
Our time is up.
I'll come visit you weekly. I promise.
You're not giving up on me, are you?
Never. I love you.
We both rise out of our chairs, and Betty leans forward, giving me a passionate kiss. How I miss the feeling of that. My heart rate skyrockets at the touch of her lips on mine. I wish we could stay like this for the rest of my life. But she breaks off and waves goodbye. I watch with longful eyes as she walks out the door. The guard returns into the room and motions me to get out. He escorts me back to my cell. My mind still locked on Betty and everything she said. Should I go back into the world and cure myself? Would my victims want me free, or rather see me punished for what I did? I didn't have an answer. My thoughts moved elsewhere very quickly, though, when I returned to my living quarters. Inside, 3 men were waiting for me, one pinning Oswald to the wall. Ranger, Prick, and Baldy. The horrid Trinity has come for revenge.
The man of the hour! Hope you had fun talking to your little lady, because she ain't gonna recognize you anymore once we're done.
I turn around and see that the guard that was once with me is long gone. Of course he is.
No one here to save you. It's just you and us.
Let Oswald go! He's not part of this! Surprisingly, Ranger listens to me and drags Oswald out of Baldy's hands and tosses him at me. He stumbles to a halt. Oz, get out of here, quick!
And leave you to fight off the Trinity by yourself? I don't think so.
This is my problem, not yours. I don't want you to get hurt just for me.
No offense, Bruce, but this ain't just for you. It's for the whole damn prison.
Without a warning, Oswald swings around and clobbers Prick with a right hook. Unprepared, he lands down hard on the ground. Baldy throws himself at me as Ranger begins to spar with Oz. I try to get out of the way, but I'm too late. I'm slammed against the back wall. Baldy starts pounding on me, throwing punches at my side. I dodge one just before it hits me, and his hand makes painful contact with the wall. I knee Baldy with all of my strength, and I'm free of his iron hold. I punch him in the face, then the sternum. Lastly, someone behind me grabs my arm. Prick is back in play. Baldy punches me in the throat, winding me badly.
Remember that, punk?
Prick grabs my arms and locks them with his own. I try to break out of his grasp, but he's surprisingly strong for someone who looks like a bundle of sticks. I guess that's something we have in common. Baldy continues to use me as a punching bag, and my head starts spinning. Dazed, I note Oswald actually knocking Ranger to the ground, but Prick and Baldy are too busy with me to notice. Prick throws me at Baldy and he catches me in his meaty mitts without hesitation. Prick pulls out something from his front pocket now. His ace, in the hole now in his hand. A shank.
Enough dicking around. Let's end this thing.
He steps eerily closer and closer, flicking the shank in the air and smiling like a rabid hyena. A fist slams into the side of his head unexpectedly, though. Oswald the hero saves my ass again with a hard knock of his hand. Prick and Baldy are distracted for a moment by his sudden appearance, so I break free of Baldy's grasp. But then, the worst happens. Prick gets a kick onto Oswald's stomach, and quickly stabs his shank into his chest. Oswald! Red blood wells out of the newly formed wound, and Oz falls to the ground.
You're next, big boy.
My vision starts to blur, and I hear my heart pumping rapidly. Prick yanks the shank out of Oswald, and moves slow and steady at me, like a leopard stalking its prey, ready to strike without mercy. I feel him. I feel the monster. He wants control. He wants it bad. Don't! Stay! I look at my arm, and I can see my skin tone shifting to green. Stop! My body jumps at Prick, knocking his weapon from his hand, and my fists crash into him like sledgehammers, raining down on him. I want to restrain myself, but the monster inside me won't stop. Don't! No. Do! He stabbed Oswald. He's getting what he deserves.
Please!
My hands are blood red, and my thoughts are only on not stopping, nor caring what's happening around me. Sirens blare out and feet run around outside, but it's just me and Prick.
Holy hell!
I suddenly snap out of it and really see what's happening. What's left of Prick's head is making a mess all over the floor. Look what I've done. I lost control and look what it cost. Though he was truly a dick, he was still a human being. Was. I get off of him, and without any second consideration, both Ranger and Baldy run out of our cell in terror. I kneel down beside Oswald and apply pressure to his wound. It looks deep.
We really showed him, didn't we? This better be in the goddamn papers or I'm canceling my subscription.
You mean you really showed them? You saved my life, pal.
That's what friends are for. You know, you got a hell of a condition. Thought you was a cucumber.
Tell me about it. Oswald scoots my hand off of his wound lightly, and I feel a hot tear run down my face. But he just smiles up at me.
It's all right, Bruce. You better have a good life. Don't waste it or I'm haunting your ass.
You're one of the bravest and nicest men I know, Oz.
Oh, shucks. You're making...
The life in his body goes out. The man who could have made my time here a living nightmare but instead helped me, showed me how to survive, treated me like family, is gone. Never to tell me one of his wacky stories or give me advice. I stare in sorrow at the man I knew for only a short time, but made a lasting impression on me I will never forget. My numb senses come back to me as I realize the prison's alarm system is wailing. I wipe my tears away and get up on my feet, walking to the cell bars to try to see what's going on. Gunshots. Some serious shit's going on, obviously. Guess the guards will be put to the test after all. The reverberating yells and screams creep closer to me. My heart rate increases. Someone must be trying to break out, and it sounds like they're succeeding too. There's a hard crash followed by the scattering of what was once the wall on the ground, and I reel around. I was right about the break part, just not the out. A small group of kooky dressed men pose in my cell. The wrecking crew has broken in.
Stay right there if you know it's good for you, Doc.
I didn't know the circus was in town. Nice of you boys to drop by. I could really use some cheering up.
Why, I ought to scramble you like an egg.
Do you really just say that?
Enough, you imbeciles!
The leader strides in like he owns the place. Smirk of success on his face after his goons manage to secure Ravencroft. things are falling in line for him.
Ah, Dr. Banner. Or should I call you by the other name the media has draped you in? The Hulk.
I don't know what you're talking about, Avocado Man.
Spare me the idiotic banter already. I already know your secret, so denying it is only a waste of oxygen.
Speaking of waste of oxygen...
What harm would there be in listening to what I have to say?
I could think of a lot of ways it could harm me. Mainly losing more brain cells, but you know what? I've got nowhere to go, and the more you talk, the sooner the remainder of the guards will be here, so go ahead.
Oh, the guards won't trouble us. But I am grateful you're willing to listen to my proposition. Did you take a look at my puppets? They are not simply your average blocks of meat, but the products of what your experiment would do if you were triumphant.
You're kidding.
Did you yourself observe them breaking into your cell with ease? Did you hear any sort of explosives? Any sort of drills? No, no, no. That was just their fists accomplishing that. They are Erkskin Super Soldier Reborn!
But how? What did you do differently?
I shall show you it all, but only under one condition.
Let me guess. You need my help.
In a manner of speaking, yes. Though your desired results are strong, having the Hulk in my little rogues gallery would be the cherry on top, as they say. With you at my side, we would be unstoppable. Not a force on this planet could stop our team.
This is all very...
invigorating?
Cliché. Why don't you come with me and we'll go find the B-superhero movie you came out of so we can return you?
Oh, you laugh like the rest now. No one's going to be laughing once my plan's in motion. It's absolutely foolproof.
And what is it? Firing a laser from space to melt the polar ice caps? You're a little late on that one.
Your juvenile spurts are no help. No, my plan is simple. The world has gotten too weak. People that are surviving these days weren't meant to live on. But thanks to modern medicine, they're bedelving the strong. The weak waste supplies that the strong need, and it's time for a change. I will be releasing every disease kept in the CDC on the world, creating a new plague, and allowing the Alpha to rise! Now, my doctor, will you join me?
Like hell I will. You're going a little too Darwin for my taste.
Huh. My powers don't seem to work on your intelligent side. Expected...
powers?
Wrecking crew! Give the doctor something to stress about!
Now wait a sec.
You heard the man!
Before I know it, the so-called wrecking crew is inching closer to me, surrounding me on all fronts. I spin around, trying to figure out a way out of this as they creep into my personal space. You can't solve every problem with violence, but sometimes... I punch Wrecker straight in the nose and he staggers out. I feel a hard hit on my side and another on my mid-back, and I'm down on the ground. Kicks bash into me while I try to get back up. I grab one of the legs and tug it down, sending its owner sprawling. But that didn't help me much. The pain makes my eyes water, and worse, I feel him coming. I try to temper down my anger, but with each hit, it gets harder. My blood feels like it's molten lava. My muscles start hurting. If I lose it, the creep could apparently control me. It's time for me to control myself. Another hit, and another. Stop. I want it to stop. I want all of it to stop. I'm gone.
Hulk, stop, puny punks!
Before the Hulk can slam his fist down on the wrecking crew.
At last! Hulk, I wish for you to follow my orders.
I feel Hulk give in prior to when I'm tugged away from any remnants of control I had. In fact, under the leader's control, I completely black out. I don't know how long I'm gone. I feel nothing until a blinding light starts flashing at my eyes. I use my hand to shade my eyes as they adjust and then widen when it comes to me where I've ended up. Back on the street where it all happened. Where I realized how horrendous the monster inside me could be. Right on schedule, too. I watch as Hulk crushes Abomination into the pavement. Dust kicks up and makes the battle harder to see. People stream away from it in panic. mothers with their children in hand and whatever they could carry out of their apartments, fathers desperately tailing behind, young helping old. All because of me.
Come on, man! We gotta get out of here!
A man tries to drag me away from the duel, but I remember something. The family I murdered. They could still be alive. I break from the guy's tug and run towards the complex.
Wait, where are you going?
I don't look back. I simply run as fast as I possibly can while Hulk continues beating the hell out of Abomination. Here it is. I whip the door open without even bothering to knock and dash inside. I can't help but look at the family photos adorning the walls. A happy family in the park. First birthday. Father and daughter fishing trip. Not bloody, battered corpses crushed under rubble. I tear my eyes away from the pictures and see them all in person. They're huddled underneath a kitchen table. Mother snuggling with her daughter and father wrapping his arms around the pair of them. I can almost hear their thoughts. What the hell is going on? Will we make it? We have to make it. Everyone expects to make it out of situations like this. But it's not always the case. You need to go! Now! If you don't, you'll... I try to warn them. Try to reverse my mistake. I can't. The earth shakes under my feet. Pictures clatter down and then the ceiling caves in. Debris shoots through and destroys anything unrelentingly. I'm knocked down, but surprisingly unharmed. I get up quickly, as soon as the remaining remainder of the apartment crashes down to the ground. The last thing I ever wanted to see again is in front of me again. The family, sprawled out lifeless when Hulk lifts up the piece that did it, but doesn't seem to care about what he just did. Just about how much he can hurt Abomination. Before I know it, I'm wailing down at him with my fists, each strike hurting my hands more. How could you do this? You monster! You killed them! You took them away! How can I do this? I collapse down on my knees and let the fresh tears slip down my face. I'm interrupted by Hulk once again.
Ha ha! Banner weak!
He punches me into the back wall and every part of my body cries out in pain. I'm dazed for a moment. Everything's a blur. But then...
You did this to us!
We would still be alive if it weren't for you!
You're a terrible man!
Their lifeless, disfigured corpses suddenly find their life and creep closer to me. I try to get away from them, but their cold hands claw at me.
You killed us!
Murderer!
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 They surround me, smearing their blood on me. I close my eyes. This can't be real. It's just in your head, Bruce.
Hulk, take care of the guards. The new plague is about to begin.
I black out again. I don't know how much time I have left before it's too late to stop Big Head's so-called new plague. I need to talk to Hulk. There's gotta be a way to reach him around here somewhere. The lights come back on at least, and a refreshing gust of wind whispers past me. I smell freshly mowed grass and the sweet sound of birds singing. I climb up a hill and the tall tree starts to come into view. I recognize this park. It's where I took Betty for my first date. I remember being so nervous around her for weeks before I finally built up the nerve to ask. Turns out she'd been waiting for me to ask the whole time. It brings a smile to my face for a moment, but fades as soon as it arrives. I need to focus. I make it to the top of the hill and find the wooden picnic table we sat at that lovely night. It's occupied at the moment by a mother, father, and daughter. My eyes widen a little when I realize who they are. My victims. The little girl waves at me and both parents give me a grin, surprisingly. The father motions me to join in, but I hesitate.
Come on, there's plenty of room. Join us, Bruce.
I decide to take him up on his offer, hoping it will lead me to Hulk. I take a seat next to the little girl, and she beams up at me.
Hello, my name is Rosie, and when I grow up, I want to be a veteran.
Veterinarian, dear.
Yeah, veterinarian. I want to help dogs and cats and little baby bunnies. I'm gonna be the best veterinarian ever.
Yes, you are, sweetie. Adorable, isn't she?
I find it hard to say anything. Guilt burdens me even more. Just looking at them almost brings tears to my eyes. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I only wanted to help, but I only made things worse. I should have locked myself away before any of this ever happened. Then you'd still be alive.
You can't change what happened. There's no need to think about how you'd do it differently. Just what you can do now.
It's hard moving on. I can't stop thinking about what I did. I hear you in my nightmares. The image of your bodies is forever stained into my mind.
You will never redeem yourself if you don't learn how to live with this.
You're right, pal.
My eyes raise at the sound of a familiar voice. Sure enough, Oswald and Betty walk up the hill together and take a seat at the table.
Well, this is lovely. Behind all that darkness in your mind, there's some kind of paradise. Sounds like a good metaphor. Or something.
Oz, if anyone knows better what happens when I try to do something right with the monster living inside of me, it's you. I'm the only reason why you died.
Bullshit! I chose to stay and help you on my own accord, man.
But none of that would have happened if I'd just stood by and let the Trinity do their thing.
All your actions have consequences, Brucey. Good or bad. If you'd have left them to their devices, people'd still get hurt. Maybe even killed. No. I died in process. You could have saved a lot of people because of your actions. People die, Bruce. It's part of life. Save as many as you can, but know that you can never save them all, no matter how hard you try.
Then why should I even try? Why not just end it all? Be the sacrifice that kills the monster for good! The colorful scene around me fades into a dreary one. The wind, once sweet, now batters me. The song of birds is replaced with loud traffic. I'm standing with my back against the Brooklyn Bridge, looking over a watery grave.
You already tried this, don't you remember?
I look over to my left and see Betty clinging onto the bridge, staring at me with sorrowful eyes. She points to my right, and I look just in time to see my past self do what I just mentioned. A sacrifice. The old Bruce jumps off the Brooklyn Bridge without a second consideration. Before my past self can take his last breath, the monster saves him. The same feeling of anger washes over me. I wanted it to be over, all of my suffering. It was the only way to guarantee that he couldn't hurt anyone anymore. He, of course, didn't want that. He only cares about one thing. Destroying anything and everything in his path to get what he wants.
You're dealing with this the wrong way.
And what is the right way?
Head on. He's part of you now. You have the power to use him for good. Learn to control him.
How?
Talk to him.
And what if he doesn't listen?
Make him. You're Bruce Banner, the smartest man I know. If anyone can do this, it's you.
Thanks, Betty. She leans in and gives me a quick kiss for courage. I know what I have to do now. I step off the bridge like I did only a month ago. This time, instead of ending my life, I'm saving it. I splash down hard, the cold water engulfing my entire body as I sink towards the bottom. Suddenly, though, I begin to rise up like a thread was pulling me. When my head pierces the surface, I'm surprised to find the Brooklyn Bridge has vanished, and in its place is some sort of lone island with a large cave taking up most of it. I swim as fast as I can to it, and pull myself up into the mouth of the cave. The rocky inside is mostly quiet, except for the few drips of water echoing throughout the tunnel and what sounds like heavy breathing. I continue to walk as my eyes start to adjust. I keep my guard up just in case I stumble upon any more surprises. Just then, I see him. The Hulk. He's sitting down in the cave all by himself, eyes looking down on the ground as if he's lost in deep thought. Knowing the Hulk, he's probably simply trying to figure out what building to destroy today and whose life to ruin. His eyes dart up at me when he hears the sound of my footsteps, and I stop in my tracks, holding out my hands. He begins to rise from his spot. Easy there. I just want to talk to you.
Hulk no like talk to Banner. Banner boring.
Please, just-
Banner boring!
Listen to me, you big idiot. For once in your short but damned annoying life, listen. You owe me that much. To my surprise, he actually sits there and waits for me to talk. Look, we've had a troubled past, you and I, but we're stuck together for the time being. Instead of constantly fighting each other, I say we come to an agreement. This leader guy, he's bad news. We have to concentrate to break out of whatever mind control he's using. It didn't work on me, but it works on you. He's playing you like a fiddle right now.
Hulk not fiddle! Hulk is Hulk!
Then let's do this thing. Focus. Break out of his control. The scene around me shifts once again. This time, I'm at last free from my mind, and back in the real world. It seems Hulk is back in control too. We look around briefly at our surroundings. Bodies lay strewn amidst broken glass from the towering CDC building. I can't help but feel responsible. Should have gotten to the Hulk sooner. The wrecking crew in front of us create their own entrance to the structure. Guards scramble to take action, drawing their firearms and pointing them at us.
Stop right there! Put your hands up and nobody will get hurt.
Yeah, likely story, pal.
Bulldozer rips up a bit of the floor and chucks it at the guards. They cringe in fear, not thinking fast enough to actually try to move out of the way. Luckily for them, we jump in the way. The sheet of flooring becomes rubble as soon as it hits Hulk.
Hulk, what are you doing? I command you to pummel these guards!
No!
Have it your way then. Take care of him, you goons!
Wrecking crew! Let's wreck this idiot!
They surround us on all fours. The blonde one has the genius idea of climbing on Hulk's back. He attempts to get Hulk into a chokehold while two of the others go for his hands, and the last one punches our legs. Just like in the prison, the guards are helpless. They simply run away and let us handle the situation. Must get paid minimum wage, or they never saw we'll have to take down a 7-foot green monster in the job description.
Come on! Blackout, you son of a bitch!
Hulk slams his back against the wall, trying to get the annoyance off. After one hit, he's still stubbornly holding on. Another slam against the wall, still locked on his neck, but his grip is beginning to slip. Hulk rapidly smashes his back on the wall a few more times, the wall itself getting ready to give out. At last, the little punk lets go and collapses to the ground. One down, three to go. Hulk stretches his arms up and down. The iron grip of the two thugs breaks, and they too join their friend on the ground. Unlike their friend, however, they're still in the game. They jump off the floor in a flash and continue trying to take down the monster. Punches fly left and right, but nothing sticking. We feel every one of them, only aggravating Hulk even more. The one still trying to take Hulk down by the legs is still at it. Well, was still at it. Hulk picks him up with his left hand, glaring at the little man.
Holy shit!
He's flung through the air, and he smashes into the nearby wall. Out cold. I would feel bad for these idiots if they weren't trying to, you know, kill most of the population. There's still a matter of the other two.
Boss, I don't want to do this anymore. This guy's nuts.
Take care of this, or I will take care of you!
Yes, sir. Well, you the boss, boss.
The orange one runs at me again, almost half-heartedly. We've got just the thing for him. A kick straight to the chest. It's a good thing these guys are strong, because any normal person would probably be looking at a lot of broken bone. The kick sends him back a little, as the last remaining one delivers a sharp punch to his back. Shit, that hurt!
Come on!
We wheel around and take another punch to the chest. Stings, but nothing we can't handle. Hulk picks him up and flings him into the ceiling. His legs poke out from the top and wiggle around. Hulk turns back to face the last wrecking crew member. Orange guy. Yeah, I'm sure these guys have names, but I don't care right now. He throws in the towel, fainting. Our attention is turned to the leader now.
Now, let's not overthink this situation. Consider this fact. The path we currently take will lead to overpopulation, a larger food shortage, lack of living space, and eventually the death of the human race. What's 1 or 2 billion dead compared to complete extinction? Help me do this, Dr. Banner, and I shall promise to cure you of your horrible ailment. What do you say?
The leader now finds himself embedded in the wall. I feel myself returning. Hulk flops down on the ground, and the painful shift back to me progresses. At last, I'm back to my old self. Does that answer your question? I hear the distant sound of police sirens advancing. My job's done. I realize suddenly that I'm still a wanted man. What are the chances that I'll find another Oswald back in prison? Oz is irreplaceable. And perhaps I don't belong in jail like I used to believe. I start running as fast as I can before the police arrive on the scene. I keep thinking about how great it feels knowing that I actually managed to do something not horrible with the Hulk. Maybe he could be used for good. I don't know when I'm stuck in Folsom prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. There's rich folks eating in a fancy dining car. They're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me. I find myself in a cafe on Madison Avenue, thinking over my future with a mildly adequate cup of coffee. I can say this much, though. It beats the coffee from Ravencroft. I swear, they make that stuff from dirt out in the courtyard. I adjust my sunglasses and make sure my navy hood is still secured on my head. I may look like a dumbass, but at least no one will know who I am. My plan so far is to leave New York and go somewhere safe out in the middle of nowhere so I can hopefully master the Hulk. Then, a man approaches my table, and my heart rate increases a little. This isn't an ordinary man. He looks like some sort of secret government agent. Just my luck. It's my first day on the run, and Agent Eyepatch has already found me.
You know, this wouldn't be my first choice for a cup of coffee. The place just down the block's got a killer cappuccino. I do admit, though, the pie here ain't half bad.
I'll keep that in mind, thanks. I was just thinking about going, so feel free to take my seat. I begin to rise out of my booth, but the man pushes me back down and takes a seat across from me.
Before you do, I think you're gonna want to listen to what I have to say. I can help you with the whole wanted situation.
And how's that? What are you, witness protection? I bet you heard about my research and want me to continue it so the government can have a squadron of Captain Americas. If that's the case, you've got the wrong guy. You're looking for mutated green bean, probably locked up in some black site by now.
That's not exactly what I had in mind, no. As for who I am, you have my business card.
Business card? It hits me. Betty gave me a card when she visited me back in Ravencroft. I dig in my pocket, and sure enough, it's still there. Strategic homeland.
It'll do just fine.
There's a tracking device in this thing, isn't there?
Had to keep a tab on you somehow. I must say, I enjoyed watching you work at the CDC building. I thought about stepping in, but it seemed like you had everything under control.
That wasn't me.
So, hold up. So, you're telling me that the hook just disappeared, and you took his spot in the blink of an eye?
Yes. Fine. All right, yes, I'm the Hulk. Now, if you want to take me in to experiment on the Hulk, you've got another thing coming to you. You saw what happened to those super freaks. Just imagine what he could do to an average guy like you.
Average? Huh. Well, no, that's not why I'm here. But I figured I could use your little secret as leverage.
Nice.
Don't worry. It'll stay under wraps if you cooperate. Look, here's the deal. We need your help, Dr. Banner. Not Hulk's help. We're currently looking for an ancient artifact with the power to change the world. Especially if the wrong hands get to it first. The artifact in question puts off a gamma radiation signature. And Stark, well, suggested you. Since you have experience in that field and all.
Artifact with the power to change the world. Wait. Did you say Stark? As in Tony Stark?
How many other Starks do you know?
Well, there's Howard Stark, but, well, never mind. So you're saying that you want me to work with Tony Stark to find some sort of mystical object to save the world? And Hulk won't be involved?
Exactly.
Then count me in.